Old School Lame Casual Chats is brought to you by Old School Lame, producing various content from blogs, videos, and podcasts discussing about movies, TV shows, video games, and everything else in between since 2011. You can check out the podcast on Anchor, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, Overcast, Breaker, Pocket Cast, and YouTube. We're associated with Channel Frederator, Manic Expression, The Comic Book Cast, and The Aaron Mehta Show.
Well, he's a fat cat, a cool cat, nobody's fool cat, but look out, cause here comes Garfield. He never keeps fit, he's too hip, he likes his catnip, well, look out, cause here comes Garfield. He's always got to be one up on ya, and he'll beat you to the punch every time. He'll give up anything for lasagna, unless he has to give up on his nap time. Well, he's a neat cat, a fun cat, Mr. Number One Cat. He knows what life is all about. Here comes Garfield. Look out, here comes Garfield. Look out, I said, here comes Garfield. So you better look out. Here comes Garfield. You better look out.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of Casual Chats. I am Patricia, and I am here with two special guests to discuss about the Garfield movie that just recently came out in theaters and is currently out on various streaming services that you can rent for a few dollars, but it will be uploaded on, I'm sure, Netflix or something like that within the next month or so. So I'm here with Chris, a.k.a. RowdyC from TV Trash.
Yo, and hello.
And I'm also here with Jim Bevan. Welcome, Jim.
Hey, great to be back.
Yeah, so I guess it's kind of inevitable that I talk about the Garfield movie at this point, because almost 2 years ago, I did my quick Christmas classics look back, and I discussed about the Garfield Christmas special, and I talked about how it's one of my all-time favorite Christmas specials that I grew up with, and I also am a huge fan of the comic strips. And I also loved the 1980s incarnation of Garfield with Garfield and Friends, the specials as well as the animated series. And so I thought to myself, you know, at some point I needed to tune into the Garfield movie, not only because, you know, Garfield, but also it is the return of director Mark Dindal, who directed various films such as Cats Don't Dance, The Emperor's New Groove, and Chicken Little. And yeah, this is the first time in over 15 years that he's coming back to direct an animated film. So I thought, okay, well, let's see how this turns out for him. So, yeah, I'd like to know from the both of you. Tell me about your history of Garfield.
Well, yeah, I'm actually really glad that I finally get to appear on a production to discuss Garfield in any form of a fashion whatsoever, because I know probably a lot of people have known me for my reviews of the Charlie Brown Peanuts TV specials. And really the only reason I never got into, did any videos on the Garfield specials myself, was simply because that long-haired creepy guy beat me to it. So I just made it like a decision saying, okay, I'm going to let him have those and I'll stick with Charlie Brown as far as in a more or less professional capacity. But Garfield has always been one of my, not just one of my, but basically the very first major character that I really developed an affection for. In fact, to this day, I know you can't see it because we are audio only at the moment, but right behind me, just show an example, right behind me on my bookshelves, I've got the first 49 Garfield strip collection books. And in fact, the first 36 of them are in the original 4x9 dimension format that the books were originally released in before they switched to the 8x9 format that most of those comic collection books are known for. And you brought up Garfield and Friends. I myself have all of the original Garfield animated TV specials from the 80s, plus the entire series of Garfield and Friends on DVD. Those are among, in fact, I would probably say that Garfield and Friends might, at worst, would be number two all time on my favorite TV shows list behind Al. And it's a very close call there, just so you could say all that much. There was a reason why I definitely needed to eventually do my own video a couple of years back, ranking my favorite episodes of Garfield and Friends in particular.
Right. Now, speaking of creepy, I did wanted to invite him over to the podcast, but there are some unfortunate family emergencies that he is going through at the moment. So I hope that he and his family do really well if he does listen to this podcast. So
Absolutely.
yeah, we are rooting for you, creepy, and we hope that things turn out well for you. So yeah, how about you, Jim?
Well, I can't say I'm as much of a Garfield aficionado as Chris is. I stopped collecting the comic anthologies somewhere when they got into the '30s, and unfortunately, I ended up losing most of them as I've moved houses over the decades. But my introduction to Garfield was the 80s cartoon with Lorenzo Music. Before that, I didn't even know it was a comic. Yeah, I just watched a few episodes on Saturday morning. I found it amusing, and my dad let me know about the comic, and from there it just ended up crossing over. And like I said, I've never been the biggest fan, but I mean there are a lot of episodes that still hold up surprisingly well for a licensed 80s cartoon because it just put a lot of effort into the writing and the characterizations to make the, to make even snarky, sarcastic cats seem, affectionate and relatable.
I do agree.
Basically, yeah, Jim Davis always likes to say Garfield is basically a human in a cat suit when talking about it. And that resonated, I think that resonated a lot, especially in the animation from the 80s as well. I like to say, like, Garfield basically, I think show like Garfield and Friends, it really set the tone for shows that would came later, like Tiny Toon Adventures and Animaniacs, in using good comedy for social commentary that even young audiences could kind of appreciate.
Yeah, for
Yeah,
sure.
I definitely agreed.
Yeah, and I think that next to Charles Schulz, I think Jim Davis has definitely become an influence for a lot of comic strip creators. I think that that type of sarcastic, cynical humor has definitely crossed over with various comic strips over the years, and even with animated series as well, especially if we were to look into Garfield and Friends, where we have many writers and animators who contributed a lot into that cartoon. I'm sure that Chris, you can probably go in depth with it, with talking about just how much of an influence we're, we have a lot of the amazing directions from Phil Roman. Then there's also the music by Lou Rawls and Desiree Goyette. And of course, you have the amazing writing that we've seen with all of the Garfield specials. I mean, Jim Davis actually did contribute to a lot of the Garfield specials. And I think even Lorenzo Music even wrote a few of them. And yeah, and of course, you have Lee Mendelsohn, and you also have various other people who worked on the Peanuts animated specials to draw the early Garfield specials. And even with all of those people, I think that the main person who has always been credited for creating like the snarkiness of Garfield, I mean, I guess it's a bit of a debate, but of course Jim Davis always gets the major credit. I mean, as he should, because he it did create the character after all. But I've also seen from various other people over the years that another person that they give major credit to, in addition to all the animators and all the people who had worked on the show, I think I guess there's no denying about the influence of Mark. So why don't you talk about that, Chris?
Yeah, absolutely. Just it is really amazing to hear the history of Mark Evanier and just how he was able to use Garfield and Friends to basically kind of vent a lot of his frustrations, as it were, about the status of where animation was for a long time in the late 70s and 80s. Of course, Evanier was also a key writer before that on the animated adaptation of Dungeons and Dragons, as you're aware, and he's more or less made his views known about how much restrictions and regulations he had to deal with, basically at the demands of parental groups all across of the country, that he had to depict certain characters in certain ways. And of course, the Dungeons and Dragons cartoon was more or less one of the main contributors to the classic trope known as the complainer is always wrong, as was portrayed by Eric the Cavalier in that particular cartoon. And he just, it was just like, once he got the opportunity to write specifically for Garfield and Friends, it was just given a lot more creative freedom as the late 80s had approached.
Yeah.
His ability to just create social commentary by creating parody characters like the Buddy Bears, or just being able to show guys like Garfield and going up against his foes like Nermal and whatnot, and just creating so many other new characters like Binky the Clown and other type of antagonists that Joy spoke like in the social areas, just was, it was almost, it's very much, you almost could say it got an inspiration for things like even South Park as well, only they were still able to, at least Garfield was able to do it in a much more family-friendly version.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, less mean-spirited, less hostile, and I think that's what makes it stand up so well.
You also bring up the music there, and I guess we definitely need to get in a two cents about that, because one, I think it's amazing that it was something like Garfield that introduced people like me at young age to such a musical legend like Lou Rawls, who, yes, it was a huge vocal contributor to a lot of the music back then. And then I've always said that Desiree Goyette has one of the most underappreciated voices in all of vocal or music history. I rank that lady right up there with the likes of Celine Dion. It's just, you know, just how much praise I've always tried to give her. And in fact, there's another special I think she had a very large contribution to, called, I believe, No Man's Valley, that I think is due for a review of mine at some point in the future.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and not only that, but Desiree also provided the voice of Nermal in Garfield and Friends, and she also did a lot of rotoscoping for some of the specials. Like, if you ever see the first special, which is Here Comes Garfield, where you got to see a lot of rotoscope moments, like that introduction where Garfield is dancing around, that is actually Desiree Goyette dancing as Garfield. And then they just animated around it so that they can be able to have Garfield flow really naturally. So I thought that, you know, Desiree has an amazing voice as well as her performance as Nermal, but yeah, she also contributed just as much as anybody else who worked on the show. So yeah, Now I know that we're beating around the bush talking about all the other Garfield incarnations, so I guess we can quickly discuss about the live action Garfield movies right before we go over to our main presentation. So I remember seeing the first movie a long time ago. I've never seen the second one, A Tale of Two Kitties, so I just thought, well, I mean, it's very similar to a lot of 2000s kids movies, in which it's just like, okay, we're just gonna have these CGI animals and we're going to have celebrities voices them, and they're gonna go into like these crazy scenarios that ordinarily you would not see them in, but at the same time, like, try to give homages to the original in very shallow ways. I guess they kind of like took their cues from the live action Scooby-Doo movie, and then they just said, yeah, let's just go on from there. And yeah, I still think that the only thing that people still remember from those live-action Garfield movies is Bill Murray as Garfield. And, you know, the reason why is because he sounds very similar to Lorenzo Music. And I even love that analogy that James Rolfe did in his Ghostbusters reviews, that the person who voiced as Venkman in the real Ghostbusters was Lorenzo Music. And who played him in the live-action movie? That would be Bill Murray, and Bill Murray voiced Garfield in the movie, who was originally played by Lorenzo Music. So there you go. And I even love that joke in Zombieland where he said that the thing that he regretted was the Garfield movies before he died.
Yeah, I will say this. Look, so if there was anything good or halfway decent about those live action movies, number one, it was Bill Murray's portrayal of Garfield, even though in the years since then, he's admitted he was never really that proud of appearing in them. And I think, I'm trying to remember, there was actually, he didn't even know what that movie was about, or he thought someone else was making it when he agreed to sign on for it or
yeah,
whatnot.
The reason why was because he thought that the director was one of the Coen brothers. And then when he realized that, oh, it's the other Coen that does like those awful kiddie movies, he was like, oh, now I can't get off of this.
Yeah, but I do think he did the best job possible. And the other thing that I will give credit is, I think the story was trying to go for the similar type of scenario. It was almost like it was trying to recreate Here Comes Garfield in a way, in showing the sense of Garfield trying to realize just how much of a friend Odie can really be. But they didn't really get... There's, like I said, this is probably best for another video at some point, but just, I don't think they got that scenario as well as they could have in the other ones. The other two things that just kind of turned me off to that movie was, one, I hate to say this because I'm sure she's a wonderful person, but Jennifer Love Hewitt's portrayal as Dr. Liz Wilson, and in fact, just as someone who grew up watching the ultra snarky, sarcastic version of Dr. Liz from the strips and the comic, from the strips and the animated specials, I just thought this person was not right to portray that particular character. And in fact, I'll say this as someone who is admitting, I'd say the point of time when the strip itself jumped the shark was when John and Liz finally hooked up as a couple. That's just my take.
Oh, so you actually are not a big fan of that.
No, I loved the snarky Liz Wilson type who was always brushing off John's advances and whatnot. That was just part of the comedy as well, because mainly because it finally sets up, it kind of made us all maybe even sympathize with John more, for those of us who grew up to basically be John Arbuckle in one way, shape, or form. The other thing, of course, as far as the movie goes, obviously this was one thing that I think really was an example as to why maybe there never should have been a live-action adaptation of Garfield at all, and that is what they did with Odie. I mean, look, I get that you see the character design of Odie in the strips and the animation, and that's pretty much impossible to convert into a live-action adaptation, even though they were able to do that for Garfield. But you just look at what they, whatever they put in for Odie himself, and you just can't see him in that and whatnot. And that just, it absolutely was a complete turnoff for me. Like, I didn't find myself despising the Garfield movies, but I did just was a bit disappointed in the final turnout, especially with the sequel, because if there was going to be a Garfield movie sequel, I definitely wanted it to be a crossover with Jim Davis's other creations, that being the U.S. Acres cast that was in the Garfield and Friends TV show.
Yeah, I guess they decided, let's just put him in Paris, because I don't know.
What is it, London. Was... They put him in London.
Oh, yeah, that's right. They did put him in London.
I know you didn't see it. Here's all you need to know. It's basically a Prince and the Pauper ripoff. Is what Garfield Tale of Two Kitties is. They just basically redo, you know, Tale of Two Cities or Prince and the Pauper. That it's that classic storyline where he's got a rich royal doppelganger that they end up switching places and everything. And yeah, there's basically no real originality in it as Gaul. So yeah, it's definitely a huge disappointment.
Oh, that's
not even Tim Curry can salvage it.
Wait, Tim Curry actually played as him?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Now I need to see it. I'm sure Tim Curry can actually salvage the movie.
Not this one.
But oh, okay. Well, that sucks. Yeah. You know, it's like, I mean, I know that there's this whole trope about, like, you know, even Tim Curry can save the worst of movies, but if he can't save this one, then that's even a bigger disappointment. I know that over the years, there's been many other animated Garfield's TV series. And I know that several years ago, Nickelodeon bought the rights to Garfield. They haven't done anything with him yet, as far as I know. But nevertheless, he's still within our pop culture as the lovable cat who hates Mondays, loves lasagna, and loves torturing John and Odie. So I guess it's no surprise that we now have the 2024 CGI animated film of Garfield the movie. So again, I just want to let everybody know that there's going to be spoilers. So if you have not seen the Garfield movie, then and you can rent it for a couple of bucks over on Amazon Prime and YouTube and various other streaming services, or you can just wait until it comes out maybe within the next month or so over on whatever streaming service is going to be coming out, whether it's Netflix or Hulu or something like that. I'm not sure where they're going to put it at, but anyway, in the meanwhile, let's go into this, shall we? So yeah, I guess an interesting thing that they decided to do in this movie is that they slightly changed Garfield's origin story, which was an interesting choice.
I was probably to save that for later, because I was wanting to bring up the positives first, but if we're going to just jump right into this, this is definitely one of the things that just kind of made me shake my head at least a bit. At the very least, it makes you have to assume that this is an alternate universe version of the character. Because as you brought up, the show introduces Garfield's father, who is a major character in the movie. And what they ended up doing is, it sets up this belief that Garfield was originally cared for by said father until they end up getting separated for one reason or another, and that's how Garfield eventually finds his way to John, who mostly more or less adopts him off the street. And yeah, that of course is a complete 180 turnaround from anyone who grew up with the original strips and comics, because now with this version, in the original comics and cartoons, we never knew who Garfield's father was. So the idea of introducing him in this, it's a good idea in concept, I think. The problem is the way they set it up. Yeah, now they've completely retconned everything, where now we don't know who Garfield's mother is in this situation. Because if you've read the strips, it's brought up in there. It was brought up in the second Garfield TV special, Garfield on the Town, and then was actually shown in detail in the special Garfield, His Nine Lives. The original story is, of course, that Garfield was born in the kitchen of Mama Leone's Italian restaurant, which is where he developed his love for Italian food and lasagna in particular. And he nearly ate the place out of business, which forced the owner to hand him over to a pet shop, which is where John Arbuckle found him. And that apparently has now been completely just tossed out the window. And I guess that's just the disappointment, is that we could have had a story where maybe those two were linked together. But now it's like we have to more or less assume that this is an alternate universe version. So apparently there is a Garfield multiverse out there.
Yeah, sure. Everything has a multiverse nowadays. Marvel with their Spider-Mans and the Avengers and... Zelda. Jeez. I mean, Ocarina of Time is the jumping point between the child timeline and the adult timeline. And yeah, I still don't even understand it.
I did a whole video series on it, and I still don't understand it.
Yeah. I think there's like four different timelines now, but even I've lost track.
What?
Yeah.
Oh my god, I've never been a Zelda fan, and even I still can't even comprehend it, but okay, fine. Yeah. If Zelda and Spider-Man and the Avengers can have timelines, so can Garfield, so there you go. Yeah, so in this universe, Garfield doesn't have a mother, he has a father, and instead of being bought by John in the pet shop, he actually went across the street where he sees the Italian restaurant Mama Leone's, and he's hungry and he wants to be able to have something. And he just so happens to see John ordering a pepperoni pizza, and he's eyeing the pizza, and he, you know, convinces John to let him in so he can have it. And of course, you know, Garfield being Garfield just goes all out and eats almost the entire place around, like, you know, the spaghetti, the birthday cake, all the appetizers, the family size lasagna. Like, of course, you know, this is our way of introducing Garfield, but in a way, we kind of get an introduction of the character through a fourth wall breaking Garfield, who's voiced by Chris Pratt.
I'm going to get this out of the way right now, as far as that goes. Just so, Chris Pratt's portrayal, his Garfield, was not bad, in my opinion. Just so you know. I thought, now, if you look at all of that, I've always been the first to say this. No one is ever going to fully replace Lorenzo Music as the voice of Garfield. He's just one of those that He's the guy you're always going to forever associate with that particular character, and for good reason. As far as Chris Pratt's portrayal goes, I don't know if he was better than Bill Murray, but as much as I hate to say this, I think he was better than Frank Welker in a lot of from the Garfield shows. And I know that's almost blasphemy to say something about a legend in the voice acting community like Frank Welker, who's done a lot of great roles in his career. Let me not make that absolutely clear. But I said this back in my review of the Garfield show with John Weber, the comic strip critic, when I said that the thing about Welker's portrayal, he got the lethargy part of Garfield down, for the most part. But he never seemed to really capture the sarcastic part of Garfield, it just seemed like. And I think for the most part, Pratt did maybe the best combination of that I've seen in some time. And I do think Chris Pratt is underappreciated. And yeah, maybe he gets a lot of roles for one reason or another, but he gives it his all and does the best. I think he does the best job possible every single time. And that's probably a reason why he keeps getting such roles.
I mean, that is true. I mean, whether it be with his performances as Peter Quill in the Guardians of the Galaxy movie, or whether it be Emmett in the Lego movies, or Mario in the Super Mario Brothers movie, I guess, you know, he's able to bring that kind of charisma that a lot of people are really gravitating to at the moment, which is why he's getting a lot of these animated roles, very similar to Awkwafina, in which he's pretty much everywhere nowadays.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that Chris Pratt gets a lot of undue hate. You know, some people don't like him because of how ubiquitous he's becoming. Some people, you know, believe some of the slander that's been spread about him, like that rumor that got debunked years ago that he belonged to an anti-gay church, which, you know, he doesn't deserve that kind of hate. I have nothing against the guy. I think he's an okay actor. But here's the thing, though. For this performance, I kind of rate it as how he did with Mario. It's just okay, it's just a pretty average performance. Like, going back to what you said, Chris, about Frank Welker, even if he didn't quite nail the full sarcasm, he was still trying to make Garfield sound like someone who was, you know, world-weary, a little cynical. I mean, even Bill Murray did that to some extent. I didn't really get any of that from Pratt. He just kind of makes Garfield sound like a regular guy.
Perhaps.
Making that memorable.
Now, I will say this. There's one thing that actually kind of put me off a bit in this. It had nothing to do with voices or anything, but really, it was the character design of John. I mean, am I the only person who looked at this depiction and immediately thought of the Onceler from the full-length Lorax movie? Like, I'm willing to bet this was made by the same animation studio, which would explain quite a bit. But that just really seemed to kind of off put me just a bit in the whole thing.
I'm not sure, actually. It wasn't done by Illumination. It was done by Sony Pictures. So maybe they got similar artists who probably worked on it. But as far as I know, I don't think it was. I don't think that they look similar. I just think that they kind of got like the. I think that maybe he's just a little bit too scrawny. Like, I know John was always scrawny in the comic strips as well as the animated specials and the animated series, both of them, but maybe his presence is a little bit more scrawnier, and maybe that's why maybe it kind of reminded you a little bit of the Onceler. Yeah, I'm just thinking along the lines of the cast, now that you brought it up. I would say that, yeah, I think that Chris Pratt as Garfield, it just sounds like you're every guy. It just sounds like a regular, sarcastic, cynical guy just voicing as Garfield. I didn't really click with him in terms of like, oh yeah, I can definitely feel Garfield in this performance. Like, I can see the cynical part. I can see the sarcastic part, absolutely. But the slow drawl that Lorenzo Music and to a slight extent Bill Murphy did was also what made the character click, was that, you know, he's a lazy cat who is just lazing around, who is constantly sleeping. He hates Mondays, and he's just always trying to find an excuse of not exercising or anything of the sort. So I think that also is very integral to the character, in addition to the sarcasm and the cynical part of the personality. And yeah, because Chris Pratt is a little bit more active in this movie where there's a lot of heist, I think that it kind of fits with the role. But this is definitely what I would say is maybe a different interpretation of Garfield from, say, compared to the comic strips or any of the animated incarnations that we've seen thus far. So yes, I guess, the surface level, it does look and feel like the characters, but I would say that there's just some other things that they tweaked around with it that it just doesn't fit right with what we have become accustomed to for the past 50 years.
It's very interesting that you bring that up, though, because there is another character whose persona was seemed to be really altered in this particular movie, and yet I found myself actually enjoying this new portrayal of it, and really found myself surprised that I found myself enjoying it that much. And that's how they portray Odie in this movie. He doesn't come off as just the complete brainless dolt of a dog that he's basically been known for all these years. The type of characters I've ended up comparing him to is, believe it or not, maybe Sideshow Mel from The Simpsons, or maybe even Squidward, of all people. He's like that sidekick character who's always having to clean up after the hero's messes, and just, he's always has this type of, well, here we go again, mindset. And I just found myself loving it for one reason or another. And I probably wouldn't have thought that going into this thing, but it was kind of a very entertaining new take on Odie.
Yeah, I actually found, I loved how they often have him doing amusing bits in the background just when the other characters are standing around talking to keep us engaged. He was actually on the ball, and I like seeing that new side of him.
Yeah, it kind of reminded me a little bit of Gromit from Wallace and Gromit, in which, like, you have Wallace who's always doing the dulcy kind of clumsy stuff in the foreground, while Gromit is just reacting to him in the background, and he's the one who's actually pulling together everything. And I guess Odie's kind of like that too, where, you know, he's just like in the background seeing Garfield stumble around or trying to do something but it doesn't work out, or just lounging and eating popcorn while all the mayhem is going. And yeah, he's actually contributing to what's going on in the background, as opposed to just him just, you know, being brain dead and clueless and just following because, you know, he wants to be with Garfield because he's a loyal dog. I guess that in some parts that is a massive improvement. So whereas Garfield was an interesting yet kind of flawed portrayal, Odie was definitely a major improvement. And as for John, I don't think they really did enough of him to say, oh yeah, I can definitely see that this is a nice progressive change for the character, because he's pretty much the same. You know, he's a struggling cartoonist, even though that maybe he's not, because he just so happens to make so much money Garfield is able to afford things like, you know, like these couches with a lot of accessories and takeout every night and all that kind of stuff. So go ahead.
I was going to say, this is something that's confused me throughout every incarnation of the franchise. They always say John is the cartoonist, but they never explain, like, what exactly he does, how successful or unsuccessful he is. Like, we only have a vague idea of his job. We never even know the name of the comic he draws or what his fan base is.
Yeah, I think as well as assume that he's a freelancer who does basically drawings and cartoons for other individuals, whatever they need from him for the most part. But I will agree that John is probably a character that gets left out for the most part in this movie. And it's actually why I looked at this and I saw this movie, like, this really felt like it should have been the second movie in an animated series of movies. Like, maybe we needed a first film that was more in detail of establishing the relationship with John and with Garfield and John and Odie, that pretty much got just condensed into the first 5 minutes or so of this one. And then a movie where we are introduced to Garfield's long lost relative, that's the plot for the sequel. I think that's how it goes. So that's, if anything, that's probably the biggest concern of mine, is that, yeah, they do more or less create this new version of Garfield, and we don't get a lot more detail into the character and the main characters themselves in this new universe before we're thrown in this whole other new character that helps, more or less takes over a lot of the story.
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you have Vic, and he just so happens to be Garfield's long-lost father. And, yeah, so Vic is an outside cat who has a gang, and they do a lot of various heists, and they steal various things. And, you know, the gang broke up because they were all locked up in the pound, and he was able to escape and never freed them. And he just so happened to have dropped off his son and abandoned him and never came back, or maybe... I don't know. We'll see what happens. And then we have another character named Jinx, who's actually the villain of the movie, where she wants to get revenge on Vic because she was actually part of Vic's group where they were stealing things. They were actually stealing like milk from a farm known as Lactose Farms. And she got caught and was sent to the pound for 5 years. And she wants to get revenge on him by forcing Garfield and Vic to steal a whole bunch of milk from the farms that they were, or, you know, they last went to. And then you have Otto, who is one of the mascots of the Lactose Farms, who wants to be able to break free his love, Ethel, who is still trapped in the farms as the attraction for a petting zoo. So, yeah, there's a lot of plot points that are actually going on. And it's like, oh, yeah, is this supposed to be like a Garfield movie or something? We have a plot involving with a heist with a cat who was who basically was dropped over to the pound and wants to get revenge on another cat who abandoned them. And then you have that same cat who abandoned his son is now coming back. And then you have a story involving with like these with this bull who wants to reunite with his loved one. And then you have a heist involving with like stealing a whole bunch of milk. Like, wow, this is very complex for a Garfield story.
I mean, look, let's be honest. Like, there, it's not like we haven't seen Garfield in crazy situations like that. If you just want to go back and look over the plots of many of the animated specials from the 80s, they've been in those type of situations before. But yeah, you're right. One is the fact that those crazy adventures took place in like the third and fourth or fifth TV specials. We had other ones that more helped establish the characters beforehand. And yes, like the fact that they've taken three or four of those simple plots and crammed them into one movie altogether. I mean, you reference Spider-Man. It's almost like what they did with Spider-Man 3, almost. Like, and that was made by Sony as well. It's like Sony has this issue of cramming too many plots into one movie off too often.
Yeah, I'm reminded, you guys probably don't remember Tyler James. He was a video producer, early 2010s, had a section called TJTV, and he did a video once looking at the Garfield and Heathcliff cartoons, and he said that one thing that they had to do to make the Garfield cartoons work, you know, is put Garfield in a lot of strange situations, because you couldn't really replicate the comic strip, because that took most place mostly in the house, and it didn't make for a lot of engaging adventures. So you do have to take Garfield out of his comfort zone and put him into some kind of extreme scenario. But when you just pile on far too many, especially ones that take the focus away from Garfield, then people are going to lose interest.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, they did the same thing with the Smurfs movie. It's like, okay, we have Neil Patrick Harris's character, and he is not wanting to reunite with his stepfather or something like that. And he also has to come up with an idea of this perfume that he needs to promote over to his company. What does this have to do with the Smurfs?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also, you have Marmaduke. Oh, geez, I mean, where do I start with Marmaduke? It's like, you know, you have this, funny comic strip about this giant dog with his family. It's like, oh, no, we need to build more tension with the family, and the dog is secondary, even though that the movie's supposed to be about him. So, yeah, I guess, you know, you have the name value and you want to be able to generate a large audience who are not familiar with the source material. I get that. But at the same time, you're going to differentiate it too far away from what the essence of the character was for the people who were fans of it, just so that you can be able to say, oh, well, the people who don't know about it, they can at least have an idea of it and maybe they'll seek it out. Well, you know, sometimes it does happen, but other times it doesn't. And maybe that movie will probably be the only source that they'll know of, even though that is not the original material.
Yeah.
And that goes back to what I was saying about how maybe this should have been the plot of a second Garfield animated movie, and probably the first one should have been more establishing the main characters and their relationships with one another before moving on to something like to adding more characters that are going to be incredibly influential in the plot.
Yeah, I guess that's true, especially since in addition to, you know, all the stuff that we just mentioned, there's also some plot twists. So yeah, it turns out that, oh my, shock, Vic didn't abandon Garfield. He was actually trying to find food for him. And then by the time that he finally got back, Garfield had already crossed the street and was meeting up with John. And so I guess very similar to Garfield's mother on, you know, Garfield on the Town, in which when, you know, Garfield's mother eventually found Garfield living with John, she realized that that was the best for him. And so she decided to leave him at home. And then maybe every once in a while, she would come by and, you know, appear out of nowhere, whether it be, you know, whenever Garfield performs on the fence with his magic tricks or with his singing, and then you have the only person who's cheering for him is his mother, or you know, maybe like she would just like look at him from the from outside, and then Garfield sees from the window that she's there, and then when he tries to find her, he's gone. So yeah, I guess they're trying to kind of like put that into Vic, where apparently throughout this entire time Vic has always visited Garfield right across the street from up a tree every Sunday, just so that he can be able to see his son happy and, you know, filled with, you know, comfort and food and all that kind of stuff. So, I mean, even at the cost of having his gang locked up in the cat pound, it's like, you know, his son is more important to him. But again, we won't know that until literally like around the end of the second act, where Garfield realizes that he needs to be able to, you know, save his father, because, you know, during the heist of the movie, you know, they get captured and they are sent to the pound, and he did that on purpose so that he knew that John was going to pick them up anyway, while you know, Vic was captured by Jinx so that he could be thrown off by the Mile High bridge in the train, which that's a bit extreme, but I guess this is how you want to do your revenge. It's like, okay, well, I didn't have him captured in the pound, I'm just gonna kill him. that's a great plan B. There's a lot of things that I can understand that they wanted to like bring excitement over to Garfield. It's like, okay, I can understand that maybe like having Garfield in the house and, you know, introducing the characters maybe for a general audience is like, you know, we want to be able to do something more exciting, but the Peanuts movie didn't have to do anything like that. I'm just curious about, like, you know, in all the years that we've had like other films based off of comic strips, they didn't take the Peanuts movie approach, in which, like, you know, bringing it to the original essence of what made those comic strips great, but delivering it into a new audience by basically just being what the Peanuts characters have always been. I guess in this case, maybe it's not enough anymore, which that's a shame, because I've always been a person who says less is more.
Agreed. You know, it's the fifth rule, keep it simple.
Yeah, there you go. Even though that a lot of people may think that simple is boring, no, simple is actually very, very complex. Like, it's much more difficult than you think trying to be simple. Like, yes, there is a fine line of trying to be engaging by being simple, but it can be pulled off really well if you know what to do. And I think in this case, I think they just did a little bit too much. But at the same time, when I think about the movie that I literally just saw a few hours ago, there's not a lot of things that I remember outside of those moments that just feel very off from a Garfield special or a Garfield TV series.
Yeah, I will give the credit that I do think they tried in trying to bring back some of the lunacy and adventure that was in a lot of those original specials. I do think there was appreciation for the characters and their history there, because they do throw in Easter eggs throughout much of the movie itself. Like, they still have Mama Leone's in the origin story, even if it's there in a different approach. And stuff like that is, like, maybe they kind of overcomplicated the plot more than it should have been, but they were still trying, I think they were still trying to honor the history of this character and franchise as best as possible. And that's why like, this wasn't something a movie that I could say I absolutely disliked. It had some good points into it. It for me, it wasn't great. It definitely wasn't the type of Garfield movie I would have created if I'd ever had the opportunity to do so. But I did find myself enjoying it in certain areas, and it's not something that I'm going to have any tie, even as much of a huge Garfield fan and Garfield purist as I could be. I didn't find myself absolutely disliking as much as I think some people were afraid might turn out to be.
Yeah, I think so. I think that, there are some things that they were able to pull off very well. Like some of the emotional moments were, for the most part, pretty spot on with Garfield. I mean, obviously with him reuniting with his father after knowing that the amount of sacrifices that he had to do so that he can be able to stay safe and secure. And also the story with Otto and Ethel was actually really, really sweet too, about wanting for him to reunite with his loved one after being put out to pasture and not being able to go back to the farm. That stuff was also really sweet too. And yes, I guess maybe a heist movie was just a little bit too out of place for a Garfield special, but at the same time, I think that there are a lot of moments from the movie that you can point out, like, oh, they actually were trying to homage the classic comic strips. Like, obviously, you have the scene where Liz, weighs Garfield and he breaks the scale, or obviously the Mom and Leone restaurant. There's even like buildings in the background where it says like Lorenzo's music store or Jim's comic books. I mean, that's actually a really nice touch. That's something that I even pointed out in the Scoob discussion where there was a lot of Hanna-Barbera references. So, yes, I would say that I think that their heart was in the right place, but I think they were trying to overcomplicate it. And I think that it just felt a little bit lost. So, I wouldn't say that this is a terrible movie. I would just say that it was more of a misguided movie.
I think that's the best way to put it.
Yeah.
I'd agree with you. And I will say that the one thing that definitely makes this movie, for me at least, was Jinx. She is the highlight, in my opinion.
She is incredibly deliciously over the top.
Yeah, just like, just this, you don't know, she's very mercurial, flying between trying to be charming and sophisticated and then just getting super rabid in her obsession with revenge against Vic.
Yeah, like she was going to the nth degree wanting to get revenge on him, that's for sure. I mean, I know that she was captured and then she was sent over to the pound for 5 years where she had to live in misery, but I mean, yes, when she tried to send him over into that task where she hoped that he would be locked up in the same pound that she was, and that didn't happen, it's like, oh, well, maybe there was another way she could have done it. No, murder. Yeah,
Yeah.
murder.
I think I could swear, I think there was a CSI episode with a similar premise where like a woman wanted revenge because the guy she was dating was a thief and he framed her for one of his heists. She went to jail for a few years. She got out and killed him. So it could have been CSI Garfield almost.
Wasn't there a South Park episode about the same situation? That kid got sent to juvie for
Yeah,
saying
that was more of a Cape Fear parody, though, I think.
very well.
Yeah. I also say Jinx gave what was Jinx delivered for me the funniest moment in the movie, the one that made me laugh. When she's calling the dairy to warn them about the robbery and she's going into intense detail, and then it cuts to the other end in the call center and you just hear coming over the line, meow, 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 meow,
That
meow.
was actually funny. That was actually the only time in the movie where I literally busted up laughing. It's like she gives up
Same.
this elaborate, detailed assignment for the people who are working on the farm, saying, I know of these cats who are going to be breaking in to the farm, and I have I you know I'm a good citizen, and I believe that I am doing my job doing so. And then you just hear meow, 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 meow. And then
And
you
then
have this security guard who gives the police officer from the bad guys a run for her money, where she takes her job really seriously, who has an animal translator, is able to know what the cat is saying, and she just does everything to prevent them from stealing the truck. That was actually pretty gold. I mean, even though that, again, the heist was out of place, at least it was done pretty well.
Agreed. And yeah, I got the similar vibes to the cop from Bad Guys with Margie's zeal. That animal translator app, that existing in the world just raises a lot more questions.
Yeah, it does. Like she can be able to translate not only cat, but also elephant and giraffe and dog. I mean, it's like, okay, I know that you run a dairy farm, but what other time would you need to use all of those other translations for all those other animals to know what's going on in your farm? Like, seriously.
Is that app available to the public? I mean, what does that mean for people who work on in meat processing plants? Do they want to hear the last words of the chickens before they go?
Oh my
Did she did does she have a descendant who would eventually go to work for Starfleet?
That raises a lot of questions that I didn't even think about asking.
I know it's one of those things that's a concept you could actually make a movie around, to be honest.
Yeah,
I'm
like you
pretty sure
could.
it's called I'm pretty sure it was called Dr. Doolittle.
No,
Oh.
okay, fair enough.
Yeah, good point.
Okay. Now I know that the movie did pretty decently in the box office from what I was looking up online in the numbers website, but then again, Mad Max Furiosa pretty much took its spot at number one. And then after a few weeks, it kind of like dwindled in popularity a little bit, and then the critics pretty much hated it, which I can understand if they had high expectations for it, but for me, I just didn't really go too much into it other than, oh, it's Garfield and Mark Dindal is back as the director. So I thought, you know, it could have been better, but then again, I mean, what more could you do for Garfield at this point?
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm just hoping that this will be you know, a major comeback for Mark to do another great movie, whether it be in the style of Cats Don't Dance or Emperor's New Groove, but only time will tell. And as for Garfield, I'm sure that, you know, the movie will probably get a sequel at some point since it did pretty decently. As for whether Mark will do the second one, I'm not sure, but again, only time will tell.
Perhaps.
All right, so I don't really have too much to say about the movie. Do you guys have any final words on it right before we conclude?
I think I pretty much summed up what I said earlier is that I found it. This wasn't probably the best way I could have seen a Garfield movie, but it wasn't absolutely terrible. It was passable for me, is probably the best way I could probably see it. The live action movies were meh to me. This one was better, I would say. That
Okay.
much. It was. I think that more effort was taking into at least showing tribute to the history of Garfield as best they can. I think there was at least more effort put in this time.
Agreed. It's passable. I hate to say this to sound disparaging, but it's a movie. It's not horrible, but it's nothing really worth seeking out. Anyone who wants to, anyone who has kids or younger siblings, you want to watch a good family-friendly movie with them, skip over this. Check out something like The Boy and the Heron or Nimona instead.
All right, then. That's fine. So, yeah, I just wanted to thank you guys so much for coming on to the podcast. I really do appreciate it.
Good thing, absolutely.
Yeah, I
So,
was happy
yeah.
to be back.
Awesome. Yeah. So, plug and promote your stuff.
Well, TV Trash should be returning in about later on this particular month. And I guess a bit of poetic irony so much. The first thing that we'll be reviewing is something I've been wanting to get my hands on all the way back since 2012. And that would be the infamous Olympic promotion special, Izzy's Quest for Olympic Gold, which I found out after finally discovering it was actually produced by Mr. Phil Roman himself. So kind of poetry going on that this comes on after we've just been discussing this.
It's
All
all
right.
connected.
Yeah, very connected.
Yeah.
How about you, Jim?
Well, I still post my occasional Magic and Myrene performances on my YouTube channel. You can just look up James Bevan. And sometimes I put stuff on Instagram too, jbevan1985. And you can also find that on Manic Expression.
All right. And as for me, you can find me at oldschoollame.net, youtube.com/oldschoollame, facebook.com/oldschoollame. I'm on Twitter and Instagram. You go over to Patty_B_Miranda and old underscore old underscore school underscore lame. You can check out the podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Radio Public, Amazon Music, all those places. New episodes will go there first, and then it'll go up in a few days on YouTube. So yeah, thank you so much for listening, everyone. Let us know in the comments below about your thoughts on the Garfield movie. Did you like it? Did you not like it? What are your thoughts on the return of Mark Dindal? And also, let us know if you want to see a sequel to this film. That's it. Hope to see you around soon. Take care.
Now we're together again. Just you and me. Now we're together again.
No need to be lonely.
Together again, my one and only.
Together again, my friend.
Just you and me.